this once-in-a-decade remap was coming up this year, the Latino Caucus collectively decided months ago that we needed to do three things: advocate for a fair map that follows the census data, have conversations and public meetings with community members, work collaboratively with aldermen outside of our caucus to draw a fair map that followed the Voting Rights Act. And that's exactly what we did. We've been doing it every day for the past 6 months. And why do we do all of that? Because of transparency. We've been warning that anything short of a rigorous and transparent remap process in public view will lead to an irresponsible and costly referendum. Using millions of dollars of taxpayer money for referendum should be the very last option. Only after all sides have actually made a good faith effort to draw a fair map that reflects demographic facts, not feelings. There's no excuse for members of the City Council to ignore city population data when drawing a fair map. Doing so and forcing a referendum, or even worse, doing so and cutting a backroom deal in the 11th hour is a violation of the people's trust. The Latino Caucus has tried many times to sit down with the city's mappers to try and negotiate, to try and work through the data that clearly shows Chicago's black population has dropped and Chicago's Latino and Asian population has grown. That respect and willingness to collaborate has not been reciprocated. Not only has the public not seen the full map being proposed by the city, no one standing here today has seen it either. Our coalition map is right here for everyone to see. We've shared our shape files with the city's mappers. All we got in return is this, the city map. We cannot and will not vote on a map that we haven't seen. It's preposterous, but unfortunately, these kinds of tactics are all too familiar. The Chicago machine of decades past is gone, but its vestiges still remain and threaten to hold us back. Here and now, it's time for the Chicago City Council to rebuild its trust with the people we represent. The way to do that is by giving this city a fair ward map that represents all of our communities. And ultimately, this map will give the people a voice to change the structure of the city for the better. The coalition map is the only fair map we've seen in full that follows data and is required by law and brings together black, white, and Latino communities, Asians, progressives, and moderates. The Chicago coalition map is evidence of statesmanship and governance at its best. This right here, this would be a joke if it wasn't such an incredible failure and breach of trust. So with that, I'll call up my colleague from the 10th Ward, Alderman Sue Garza.
Hi, I'm Alderwoman Sue Garza. I'm from the 10th Ward. I'm standing in support of the coalition map. It's a map that fairly represents every single community in the city of Chicago. And you can't beat facts. There are no talking points, no political pressure, no backroom deal that will deny the facts. Chicago is now 30% Latino. It is the largest racial ethnic population in this city, and the map should have 15 Latino majority wards to reflect that. In this city, we need our new map to reflect the population changes that have happened in Chicago. The coalition map has the first ever 51% Asian majority ward, and black majority and Latino majority wards that accurately mirror the city's population. The city's mappers have made a claim about their map, but the fact is, no one has seen it. You can't map if you don't see what's going on, and that's completely unacceptable. I'd like to introduce Alderman Raymond Lopez.
Good morning. I'm Alderman Raymond Lopez of Chicago's 15th Ward. My colleagues here today in the Latino Caucus, along with many members of the City Council not part of this caucus, are personally and deeply understand the biggest challenges in the communities that we all represent in neighborhoods all across Chicago. In order to uphold the values of equity and community-driven solutions, we need a map rooted in data that adheres to the laws set down in the Voting Rights Act, that balances the opportunities for multiple groups to elect the candidates of their choosing. So again, let's look at the data. The census released this year shows that 29% of Chicagoans identify as black, 30% identify as Latino, 31% identify as white, 7% identify as Asian. Those percentages are fairly reflected in this coalition map. In this map, 32% are black majority wards, 16. 30% Latino majority wards at 15. 30% white majority wards at 15. And again, we have to underscore the fact that for the first time in Chicago history, we have a ward that is 51% Asian. The coalition map, this map, makes sure that all communities are represented. This isn't just Latino communities, but black communities, white communities. Every community is represented and wards stronger for them, for those neighborhoods. Previous maps, as we all know, have sliced and diced communities, making it harder for residents to organize and advocate. And I can speak from experience on that one, because Back of the Yards at one point was divided into 6 different wards. Greater Englewood right now is divided into 6 different wards. No more. The coalition map respects community boundaries and keeps neighborhoods together. Neighborhoods like Ashburn, Hyde Park, Lakeview, Lincoln Park, Rogers Park, Uptown, the West Loop, Woodlawn, and neighborhoods near and dear to me like Brighton Park, Back of the Yards, and Greater Englewood. And finally, has created a unified ward in Marquette Park. I support representation rooted in data, representation that keeps neighborhoods together, and representation that follows the law and has citywide support, which is why I'm proud to join my old colleagues in the Latino Caucus for this map today. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Carlos Ramirez Rosa, and I'm the alderman of Chicago's 35th Ward, and I'm going to very quickly speak in Spanish, and then I'm going to say my remarks in English. Nosotros estamos aquí hoy día para pedir una mapa que representa la diversidad de la ciudad de Chicago. Una mapa que va a asegurar equidad y igualdad para nuestras comunidades. Que va a asegurar que cada barrio y cada vecindario va a tener una voz y una oportunidad para elegir un representante de su comunidad para el Concilio de la Ciudad de Chicago. Desafortunadamente, aunque hemos sabido, este concilio ha sabido que el 1 de diciembre es cuando tenemos que pasar una mapa, el Comité de Reglas de la Ciudad de Chicago ha escondido la mapa que ellos han estado trabajando. Y hoy día esa es la mapa que ellos tienen. No nos han enseñado nada. No nos han enseñado nada para que nosotros podamos llegar a un compromiso, para que podamos tener una negociación para llegar a una mapa que va a asegurar equidad para todos. La ciudad de Chicago, el señor Mike Casper, no ha tenido un proceso transparente, un proceso abierto, ha hecho un proceso para hacerle daño a nuestras comunidades y nuestros barrios, y no vamos a apoyar ese proceso, no vamos a apoyar esa mapa. Nosotros hicimos una mapa, lo hicimos público, hicimos una mapa que sigue los datos del censo, para asegurar que en nuestra comunidad hay representación para todos. Y esta mapa lo hemos seguido cambiando. Cada vez que recibimos más información de la comunidad, cada vez que la comunidad alza su voz y decimos queremos este cambio, este otro cambio, hemos hecho sus cambios a esta mapa, porque hemos enseñado que queremos seguir con un proceso abierto y transparente e inclusivo. En fin, nosotros estamos comprometidos a compromiso. Pero si es necesario, estamos dispuestos y listos para ir a un referendo Porque no vamos a apoyar una mapa corrupto, no vamos a apoyar una mapa que hace daño a nuestras comunidades. So I want to say, good morning, my name is Carlos Ramirez Rosen, I'm the alderman of the 35th Ward. And I've been proud to be part of the Chicago Coalition map process from the very beginning. Because we didn't pick numbers out of a hat, we said that first and foremost, we're going to follow the U.S. Census data. And once we received that U.S. Census data, we went census block by census block, we looked at who lived there, we looked at community boundaries, and we worked to create a map that closely followed the U.S. Census data first and foremost, that kept communities together in contiguous and compact districts, and that ensured that the diversity of our great city was represented in the halls of City Council and of the City of Chicago. And unfortunately, while we did that process and spoke with over 35 aldermen and community groups in this process, we were told that instead we had to map behind closed doors, that we had to map in a process that was not transparent, in a process that would disenfranchise our communities and ensure that the same old political games of the past is what would dictate the next map for the City of Chicago. We said no. And week after week we sent letters, week after week we sent outreach, week after week we tried to schedule meetings to say, let's sit down, let's negotiate, let's have a process that's open and inclusive and transparent. And every single week we were told, no, get into the map room one by one and map behind closed doors. Don't do a process that's open and transparent. That's not how we want to engage with you. We want to engage with you with the old school Mike Madigan, old school Chicago corrupt machine political playbook. No more. So I'm proud to have been part of this process because we have been the only coalition to release a map that follows the data, that has contiguous and compact districts, that keeps communities whole. And we've seen what that other process has led to. A map that up to right now has not been released for the public to see. So there's a meeting at 1 p.m. of the Chicago City Council. And we certainly hope that they're not planning to hold a vote on a map that no one has seen. And we've been told that that's not the case. I guess they realize that, you know, it was very bad luck to try and continue with this same old school tired politics. But it's time for them to show us their map. It's time for us to be able to sit down and negotiate and reach a compromise. We cannot accept a map that disenfranchises Black and Latino communities. We cannot accept a map that slices and dices communities. We cannot accept a map that puts the political interests of a connected few before the interests of our neighborhoods. We're not mapping for one individual ward. We're not mapping for a handful of powerful aldermen or special interests. We're mapping for the entire city of Chicago. And the entire city of Chicago deserves a process that is open, transparent, and inclusive. From day one, the Chicago Coalition Map has sought to have that open, transparent, and inclusive process. And it's because of that process that as people came forward in the Rules Committee meeting, as members of the public came forward and expressed their input on our map, we've adjusted our map accordingly. And I'm proud that today this map includes changes that were advocated for by the people of the city of Chicago to continue to make communities whole and to keep them intact. We're still ready and open to compromise as a coalition. I think you've heard that from every single one of our speakers today. But a real compromise, you know, a real negotiation. We do not want to have to, you know, go to a referendum, but if need be, we're prepared to do so. Thank you.
Yes, there's still 14.
No quiero otra salida que un referendo, ¿no, Guido? Pueden hablar sobre la posibilidad de un referendo. Digo, parece a esta altura algo real.
La pregunta fue la posibilidad de un referendo.
Sí, parece que es imposible evitarlo a esta altura, ¿no?
Pues mira, yo creo que hemos ido de varios miembros del concilio que han dicho que ellos quieren un compromiso, que quieren una negociación verdadera. Eso es una cosa buena. Yo creo que sí es posible aún llegar a un compromiso, una negociación. 10 años atrás el concilio no pasó una mapa hasta muchas semanas después del 1 de diciembre. Entonces aún todavía sí es posible. Pero al mismo tiempo nosotros no vamos a aceptar una mapa que es ilegal, no vamos a aceptar una mapa que hace daño a nuestras comunidades. Entonces, si ellos quieren pasar una mapa que va a hacer daño a nuestras comunidades, sí estamos dispuestos a ir a un referendo, pero siempre estamos abiertos para un compromiso, pero tiene que ser un compromiso que avanza los intereses de todos los barrios y de todos los residentes de la ciudad de Chicago.
Will there be a meeting this where are you voting, or is this vote called up? Like, what's happening this afternoon? Iglesia de Español.
So our understanding is that this afternoon there will be an introduction of the city map, hopefully different than what's appeared here. We will take a vote at a later time after public hearings have been done throughout the city.
How do you feel about that?
What does a compromise look like to you? What is your bottom line for how the board is going to be set up, Black and Board and Latino alike?
So this my colleagues in the coalition map have followed the data, the Voting Rights Act, and listening to what the citizens of Chicago want. We have put forward shape files and outer boundaries as to what it is that we would like to see based on data and the Voting Rights Act. To have a compromise within with the outer boundaries with those wards that touch it, I think needs to happen. Right now, they've drawn boundaries and said, you have to draw within the boundaries that they've determined. They have said, aldermen are locked in. But what that's done to us is lock us out because of the fact that Latinos are protected protected class as well. And we have that same right
as other protected classes to draw our wards the way that we see fit. And where there's conflicts on boundaries, we should be negotiating. We have not been given that opportunity.
When you say they have locked you out, who are you referring to?
We're referring to the Committee Rules Council, Mike Casper.
¿Qué tipo de compromiso podrían llegar a hasta qué punto ustedes podrían comprometerse en conceder en alguna de las condiciones del Consejo Americano?
Pues estamos siguiendo los datos.
Eso es la cosa más importante que nosotros como un concilio tenemos que hacer, los resultados del censo del año 2020. Y cuando vemos los datos, cuando vamos bloque por bloque para ver dónde viven los latinos, dónde viven los anglos, dónde viven las personas de descendencia asiática, lo que encontramos es que hay suficientes latinos en áreas juntos uno al otro para 15 o 16 distritos latinos, que son mayormente latino. En este momento, lo que el Comité de Reglas de la Ciudad de Chicago está ofreciendo es en realidad solo 12 distritos para los latinos, con dos distritos donde los latinos van a tener influencia, pero sobre los próximos 10 años se van a convertir en distritos mayormente anglo. Entonces, si 10 años atrás hubo suficiente latinos para 14 distritos, ¿cómo es que ahora, 10 años después, cuando nuestra población ha seguido creciendo, ahora solo tenemos suficiente para 12? Eso es injusto, esa es una violación de la ley. Y nosotros no vamos a estar dispuestos de apoyar algo que viola la ley. Entonces, un compromiso yo creo que sería 15, lo que sigue los datos del censo del año 2020. Sí hemos dicho que estamos abiertos para ver cómo se puede llegar a ese compromiso. Pero yo creo que lo que hemos hablado es 17 distritos afroamericanos, 15 distritos para los latinos. Sí es posible llegar a ese compromiso, pero necesitamos que ellos hagan negociación con nosotros. Hasta este momento no han querido hacer negociación. Cada vez que decimos queremos sentarnos en una mesa, hablar sobre cambios que podemos hacer, nos dicen no. Tienes que ir y hacer lo que te dice Mike Casper. Y eso no es una negociación, eso es injusto, es una violación de la ley.
So a big portion of the ward is going to my neighbors. We have seen a draft map. I mean, it's been publicized in the media where my neighbors, both 13 and 14, are getting the neighborhood that I live in and the majority around that I have represented for over 10 years. I was a state representative and I represented that area that I live in for 10 years prior to becoming alderman. And so, that they're telling me this is your map and this is what it's going to look like, and I don't think that's fair for our communities. What I hear from residents is that they want to see neighborhoods not sliced and diced. They want to see neighborhoods together, and that's what I hear from residents in my ward, and what we have presented is a fair map that like we have shown you here. It's a fair map for all our communities, and we want to compromise. We want to negotiate. There's no compromise. My neighbors are not willing to come to the table and compromise and talk to me, and that is wrong.
Tell us who you're talking to.
No, the 13th Ward and the 14th Ward.
That would be Alderman who?
Yes, Alderman Marty Quinn and Alderman Burke. I mean, you have seen that map that has been out there that has been leaked that puts them in, that puts my map all the way 5 miles away from my house. So the starting point of where I live to where the new 23rd Ward starts 5 miles away, and that's not right. That is wrong, and I don't want to see that for any of my aldermen, any of my colleagues who are standing here today. We are united. We are sticking together. We're not going to get screwed like we did 10 years ago. We are not, and we're not going to let Casper tell us what to do because we haven't seen it. Look, this is what they're telling us. That's wrong. That's wrong because even our mayor has said that wants transparency, that people should see the map beforehand. And the council of rules, Mike Casper, has not.
What do you all make of Mayor Lightfoot not being here, and what has her role been in all of this?
Solamente en español, voy a repetir en español, solamente very, very brief, I want to, Mike Rodriguez, is that en español es que mis colegas del 13, Distrito 13, Mary Quinn y el 14, Ed Burke, no me sacaron de mi distrito. No es justo que ellos decidieron cómo va a ver mi mapa. Una mujer hispana, no veo que eso es justo para mí. Me están están diciendo cómo va a dibujar mi mapa, ellos, y no es justo, por eso yo estoy aquí y estamos unidos con mis colegas este día, porque queremos un compromiso, queremos hablar con ellos. Y ahora voy a decir que mi chair, Gil Villegas, diga unas palabras acerca de la pregunta que hicieron.
What was the question? Tamara, I'm sorry.
What do you make of Mayor Lightfoot? She's in Washington.
Even if you guys try to work this all out?
Well, this is a city council function, and $1.2 trillion passed infrastructure, so I think that the mayor's out there advocating for the city in order to bring resources back. I know that Build Back Better has passed the House and it's in the Senate. I'm sure there's a lot of discussions around that as well, trying to help lobby and make sure that Build Back Better passes. There's a lot of dollars that are coming to the city. So we have a process in place where the president pro temp will preside over the city council, and so it'll just be business as usual for today.
Cause, does she get that you need more seats because you've had an increase in population?
Well, I would say that in our discussion with her and her, the mayor having represented redistricting over the past 20 or 30 years, understands that the data, the Voting Rights Act, are two key principles that are followed when doing reapportionments. And what we've provided her is the data, and she's very, very well versed in the Voting Rights Act. And so she understands what we're trying to do, hence why there hasn't been the process of trying to ram through a map, because of the fact that there could be potential litigation based on the data and violation of the Voting Rights Act.
She will not be at the council meeting. Can you recall a meeting where the mayor was not at the council meeting? Could you give us your thoughts on her input on this big day? Where is she? And what do you think about
it? On this matter, I'll defer to my colleagues' comments on where she is. My personal view is that we can handle this ourselves. This council has the ability to act without its mayor present. And while I can't remember a time the mayor not being here for something so important, personally, I have faith in my colleagues to get the job done one way or another.
You said you're not ready for a referendum tomorrow. Is that something you're ready to do tomorrow? I guess we might miss out on what happens today.
The coalition MAP members are constantly wanting to try to avoid referendum. But we have to have, we said it over and over, and we'll continue saying it over and over. We want to have true compromise, true negotiations that allows the ability for the Latinos, a protected class, the ability to draw their maps in a fashion
that allows for the opportunity to elect representatives from their community.
Alderman, can you address the concerns that the Black Caucus has that it's not just about numbers, that the Latino community has not traditionally had high voting numbers are low, and there's a low age, there are people who are not citizens who can't vote, and so just to go specifically by numbers isn't always accurate in their community.
Right, and so what we've heard as of late, while this is their negotiation tactics, and I'll say they mean Casper's negotiation tactics, is now the discussion and consideration of CVAP, citizens voting age population. Now let me remind you right quick that citizens voting age population would not only affect Latinos, but also affect Asians as well. And here we are on the cusp of creating a first Asian ward, and that would impact them as well. Again, double talk. Let me elaborate a little bit more. Mayor Washington, back in 86, created the Welcoming City Ordinance. This body, under this administration, strengthened the Welcoming City Ordinance. This body also, City of Chicago, signed on to an amicus brief to defeat the question of citizenship on the census. And now, Mike Casper and the Rules Committee are going to go use some Trump-like tactics to say that you're okay to pay property taxes, non-citizen. You're okay to pay those regressive fines and fees, non-citizen, but you don't have the right to representation. And so again, this is very hypocritical, racist, and puts us in a position that if you're going to start off negotiating like that, that's why we're here today. Because that's been the tone thus far on the negotiations. You do what we say. This isn't Springfield, ladies and gentlemen. This is the City Council. And we're all elected leaders here, and we represent our wards and our communities, and we're going to continue to do that. And so there's the options that are available. I would also say that the Rules Committee during the spring session tried to change the rules from the 41 requirement to bring it down to 2/3 because they knew that they were going to try to ram through a committee, a map that would have disenfranchised Latinos, but we stood up and we defeated that amendment that was in Springfield. So this is all about keeping power and not following the data and the Voting Rights Act. That has been recent discussions in his form of trying to negotiate. So yes, citizen voting age population has come up from the council of the Rules Committee. It would not only affect Latinos, it would also affect Asians as we're trying to bring on the first Asian ward in the city's history.
Yes, it is being used. It was on the map that was shown last night on Chicago Tonight used CVAP. So you guys should have a copy of that. I want to say one thing that has been going on with all of us. We dropped our maps the beginning of November. We went to the map room. When I got to the map room, it wasn't the map that I drew. I was told, first of all, our wards should be compact, continuous, and there should be no kind of disfranchising anybody that lives there. Instead, when I went in, I said, this isn't my map. They told me you can only go west into Pullman and take Alk Elk Gardens, which is 7.8 miles away from my office. It takes 21 minutes by car to get there, and a lot of folks on that side of the expressway, on the other side of Lake Calumet, don't have transportation. They would have to take a bus to a train to a bus. It would take them 1 hour and 17 minutes to get to their public servant's office. I don't care. My ward is made up of Black, brown, and white. I'm not afraid to take anybody, but to disenfranchise the 4,400 Blacks on the other side, that's disenfranchisement, and that is wrong. And that's what they want to do, and that cannot happen. And we get in there, they won't let us move. We sit there, sorry, you can only go this way. You can only go that way. That's happened to every single one of us, and it has not been a true negotiation in any way, shape, or form.
I've always been supportive of the Latino community and my Latino colleagues here. I serve different purposes in this council, so I try to keep an unbiased approach to negotiations. I'm here as obviously a colleague of the Latino Caucus, and as far as I'm concerned, I've always been in the caucus Chairman, is that right? As far as I know, I have not been kicked out. So that has not changed. Does that answer your question? I think she's in Washington doing what she needs to do. And I think this is my colleague stated, this is a function of City Council, a function of the Rules Committee, a function of each one of us to sit down and see what that map looks like for you and your communities. And force ahead to see if that meets your criteria and your vote. And if that doesn't, then obviously there's repercussions and different tactics that are going to be used. And the fact that the folks are here, because they're not happy in terms of what the outcome has been so far, it speaks to that. And I stand by them. I think the chairman can speak to what the caucus will do that. That's his function.
Do you want me to answer that question first? So well, what we're going to continue to do is continue to have dialogue. Now we'll finally see what the city map looks like, see where the conflicts are, and try to figure a way if there's an opportunity to come to a compromise. The statute clearly states what the next steps are, but this coalition map members have been willing to compromise and negotiate. However, we've said before, there has to be true negotiations and true compromise, not just us being told what we need to do. Well, I say that this is something that we've missed an opportunity thus far, but there's still opportunity to come together to put forward maps that benefit both communities. There have been sacred cows that have not been discussed on wards that haven't been touched because they've been locked in. If we were to have true negotiations, we could get to 17 black wards, 15 Latino wards, one Asian ward, and two or three super minority wards. But those discussions have to occur, and they have to happen quickly. But we can't have sacred cows. Everything has to be on the table. I mean, every time there's a reapportionment, it's a blank slate. And what we've seen thus far is Casper's Picasso, which is nothing. And so we're going to see that unveiled today. So we're anxiously waiting to see it. But I can tell you that if every 10 years there's no boundaries, and the data is what determines how the wards are going to will be reapportioned, but that hasn't occurred yet, and it's unfortunate because here we are December 1st when we're supposed to pass the map and one is being introduced. And all the members here have not seen the map. And I would also add, Alderman Garza just reminded me, that while the redistricting was occurring during the summer months and into fall, we met with 35 aldermen. So the wards that you see here are not just us throwing boxes up. We met with aldermen to find out what are the boundaries that you'd like to see. This is what the data is. African Americans, Latinos, Caucasians. So this is not something that we just made up. This is input of 35 members. Have the lines adjusted over the time? Maybe. But I can tell you that 95% of what the aldermen have requested are in this coalition map. Well, I would rather continue to have that discussion, and hopefully we can find out if those sacred cows can be spared.
Senator, dividing 19 wards into two majority 5 wards?
Yeah, I think that the City Council will have that. Both caucuses should sit down and talk about everything that's on the table. Right now, as I said, we've been boxed in, locked into areas, and our community has been locked out.
Vegas, Michelle Harris said Monday during the Rules Committee meeting that you have not been to the map room. Why would she say that?
Well, see, that's not accurate. So we've been to the map room several times. Matter of fact, we've documented how many times we have gone there. We've gone there, and we've been told that this is your area. This is where you need to draw into. These are the boundaries, the outer boundaries that we've determined are for you. And that's not how the Voting Rights Act works. It's not the first person that gets to the map draws and then that's it. There's data and data that we have to follow. We've been trying to follow Latino census tracts and blocks in order to ensure that the opportunity to elect Latino representation, and that has not been a fair and true opportunity to draw our own maps. So, yes, we've been there, but what we've been told is, this is where you can draw. This is it. So my question is, after that, how many times am I going to waste my time, waste my community's time, going to a map room where there's no true negotiations or compromise that's being applied?
Moving forward, will you, as a 11-person block, a 14-person block, will you negotiate as a block? And then if there's a compromise map, or if there's no compromise and they put forward their own map, will you vote as a block? Are you confident that, you know, your coalition will hold together and
five of them
won't be.
Yeah, no, I'm confident that we will stick together. We have said collectively that as opportunities come up for an alderman, if they fix their boundaries or any issues, then that's good. But we need the other members of the coalition to be issues to be addressed as well, to the best of the ability. We're not saying that we're going to get 100% of what we want. What we're saying is there has to be true negotiations and compromise. And what we've seen thus far is not that. It's been the least transparent process for reapportionment probably in the city's history. And that's an issue, not only for us, but for the other 2.7 million people that have to live with these decisions.
What were the union people offering you guys individually when they were calling, asking you to peel off?
Well, I would say I did not receive any calls from any union officials.
Yeah.
Okay. And this will be the last question.
In the conversation I had, nobody was trying to peel anyone off. I think people similarly to taxpayers are saying, can you guys figure this out? This is a council, this is what you're elected to do, and there's a lot of disappointment being expressed. We share that disappointment. We would prefer negotiation. We are being forced in a position. Nobody here wants to go to referendum. So the conversation we were getting from trades, from other community groups are the same. Hey, can we see an actual map that exists? What is the compromise? When can you guys figure this out? We've been asking the same thing. You want to find out where there's a challenge on compromise? You can't compromise if there's no other map to talk against. You are literally compromising yourself and negotiating against yourself when no one's presented another map. That's all we've been saying since the beginning. It is December 1st. It still hasn't been presented. And that should be a disappointment to the whole city, to the city where Harold Washington taught us what coalition should look like, and to every taxpayer whose money is going to be spent if it has to go that route.
Thank you. Bravo. Thank you. Thank you.